And we are urging you as elders to be involved in the work of Easter in your home groups. Please find out where your group is having its outreach meeting. Pray for that and take part in that. And also there are some ministries that will be having Easter evangelism as well. I'm aware there should be an Easter sing-along by the music ministry next week, Sunday evening, after the evening service, if all will be done. And the announcement will go out in the week. So we'll be praying about that. But also the churches around us are having Easter evangelism outreach, many churches, including our own missionary churches. Our church in Choma, which we've recently taken over as elders in terms of oversight because all the elders left. We're having Easter evangelism there beginning on Friday and going on right through up to Sunday. We have Pastor Rafa Banda from Mazabuka Baptist as the main preacher there. Elder Emmanuel Mkandawire will be leading a team that will go and join the team in Choma for Easter outreach work Friday, Saturday, and then the Sunday, and will return on Sunday after the afternoon service, which ends about 15, I think somewhere about 15. And Elder Mkandawire is asking if you'd like to be a part of that team, please see him and sign up. There's very limited space because of the transport. But if you'd like to be a part of that team, whether student or older than a student, doesn't matter, please tag along and help our church there with Easter evangelism. But we'll also be praying for what happened in the week. We lost our missionary pastor, our former missionary pastor, Pastor Geshom Nyorongo. He was put to rest on Friday. And then we'll be remembering especially his family. His wife is unwell. Remembering his family, his children as well, as they go through this period of the after the mourning period. So we'll remember them as well. Let's turn to the Lord in prayer. O Lord our God, we would like to thank you for the reading of Scripture read in our hearing. From chapter 37 of Exodus. And our Father, particularly the overriding theme there of the matter of excellence to do with everything being overlaid with gold, and showing, O God, therefore, how we ought to honor you, O Lord, ourselves as well, that we ought to give excellently, we ought to do excellently, we ought to follow excellently. Oh Lord our God, we pray, each one of us who is called by your name to think concerning this, you gave this craftsman, Bezalel, who was an experienced man led by the Spirit in his experience to build the things of the temple, the tabernacle, and eventually what would be the temple. Our Father, and now our hearts the temple. Things of pure, pure gold. Lord our God, help us to think carefully on this and to give, therefore, our best as well. We pray you may forgive us our sins, that quite often we come with a very lazy approach to our spiritual life, our Christian life, our church life. And our Father, quite often we do not think through the processes of what we go through. Here we see there was excellence in the measurements, in the craftsmanship, in the placement. Our Father, we pray you may help us to think through this and live in such a manner so as to honor your great name as well. And our Father, your great honor is shown, your great goodness, your great love, your mercy is shown truly in the events of Easter. The going up to the cross, being delivered by men of the Lord Jesus Christ, being delivered by men to be crucified, in fact crucified, laid in the tomb, and 3 days later raised again from the dead to sit at the right hand of God, sending out his disciples to now conquer the world in terms of preaching the message of salvation. Lord our God, we see in this the full extent of your love, the full extent of your glory as well. Oh Lord our God, as we seek to take part in the celebrations of Easter, particularly in the matter of spreading your gospel, gospel outreach to the home groups, through the home groups, to the homes, to schools and colleges, in the streets giving out tracts, gospel outreach in camps in some places, gospel outreach in the various towns and villages where we have churches, sister churches and daughter churches. Our Father, we want to pray for your grace. We want to pray, oh God, for your Spirit to move among us and to move us, that we might not go in our own strength, oh God. And that, our Father, we might find fertile ground as well, oh Lord, as we go out into these many places to bring your word. We pray for the many who are in fact preaching and teaching your word over this particular time in our congregation. We pray for the one-on-one follow-ups, oh God, whether at the meetings themselves or afterwards as we get names and phone numbers. And we ask, oh Lord, that you would give us success, fruit, oh God, in terms of men, women, and children coming to a saving knowledge of Christ as a result of our efforts led by you, O God. So help us across the town, help us across the villages and towns across Zambia where we have a presence and where, O God, we have an event. We pray thinking about our own Easter service this coming Sunday and also the sing-along in the evening, an evangelistic musical. Our Father, we want to pray again for your blessing upon us and upon your word and upon the people that will gather, O Lord. We pray particularly for the trip to Choma. Elder Mkandawire organizing a team to go and help with Easter evangelism there. Our Father, our brethren need our encouragement, they need our help, they need us to walk alongside them. But more than that, they need to see you, O God, working in their midst, amongst them and through them. Oh Lord, will you honor this request and this desire, and that this Easter, that church might be filled to the brim, as it were, with visitors and guests from the town of Choma, coming to celebrate Easter and to listen to the message of the cross, the message of the season in which we are, oh God. Lord, we thank you for Hillview Baptist, who had a crusade in the Jack compound where they're seeking to establish and plant a church, a vernacular church. We pray, oh God, thanking you for the great numbers that turned out in the night to hear the gospel. And we pray that this might indeed signify the beginning of a preaching point, but also eventually a church plant there. We pray you may crown their work, the work of preaching the gospel, with success, with hearts and minds in that poor compound, our Father, being drawn to Christ by the true message that is preached. Lord, we also want to remember, on a sad note, the losing of our brother, the going to glory of our brother, our dear former pastor, missionary pastor to Katete, Mr. Geshom Nyirongo. He was a man who gave of himself in the latter years of his life, when many choose to sit back and retire and seek to enjoy something of the labors that they've had in their youthful years. He gave himself to the work of God almost to the time that you took him. We thank you for the work that he did, 11 years as pastor in Katete. And we thank you for the way he carried himself in terms of his illness and our Father, his wife's illness as well. That our Father, he did not curse you, but he looked to you and he entrusted himself to you. And he was a model among us, oh God. And our Father, we are grateful for the time that we spent with him that you gave to us. We now want to pray for the family. We pray for Towela and for Sinyala and the brother. We pray for the mother who is unwell. We pray, oh God, that you be with them as they have the family talks, but also as they carry on from here in the aftermath of losing the patriarch of the family. Be gracious to them and be with them. And let them, oh God, follow the God of their father, the God of their mother. Our Father, let them honor their father's legacy in that way, oh Lord. Lord our God, we want to turn to our service this morning. We remember our brother Billy who continues to lead us. But we pray especially for Pastor Mbewe, who will be stepping up shortly to open up to us the scriptures. Our Father, we pray that you might be with him as he does so, and be with us as well as we listen in to your word preached to us. May your name be honored and glorified, O God, even as we've saw something of that in Exodus 37. Be glorified among us, O God, by the preaching of your word. And be glorified as we seek, O Lord, to follow the commandments in that preaching. And may many come to a saving knowledge of Christ Jesus. Continue with us, therefore, this our time in our service. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
We have come to the time that we prepare our hearts to listen to the preaching of God's word. And as a church, we have a custom of singing through the Psalms. And we'll be singing from Psalm 45. This is a poem to the king. And this was a poem on an occasion of a wedding to the king. While this psalm was written for historical occasion and purposes, but also it can be seen that it's a prophecy about our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, which speaks about him being God. Let me just read that one, which of course in Psalm 45, verse 6 and verse 7, which is quoted in Hebrews and chapter 1, verses 8, speaking about the Son, God speaks that his throne will live forever. And so in verse 6 of Psalm 45 says, your throne, O God, will last forever and ever. A sculptor of justice will be the sculptor of your kingdom. You love righteousness and hate wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has set you above your companion by anointing you with the oil of joy, which is quoted in Hebrews and chapter 1, verse 8, speaking of the Son and who is the Christ that we speak about even this morning. This Christ can be your friend, as we have had this theme, that he is such a friend that is able to take care of all our needs, including the needs of our souls. And that's our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we ask that as we'll be listening to the preaching of God's word, that you might find a friend in this, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. I ask that we will stand and we'll sing Psalm 45 to the tune of Be Still My Soul. And at the end of the singing, Pastor Mbewe will come and preach to us the God's word.
Thank you. Thank you. Please be seated. And as you do so, do turn with me to the book of Acts and chapter 7. The book of Acts and chapter 7. While you're turning there, I do want to add my voice in appeal to the coming Easter weekend. I know that I myself will be missing in action, but that's because I'll be out at our church plant in Rwanda. But I also realize that because it's a long weekend, most of us tend to make plans to go and catch up with funerals and other activities out of town that we missed. And it's very possible, therefore, for what is really a God-given opportunity that even the secular world is thinking about Easter. It's a God-given opportunity. It is very possible for us to miss the opportunity of reaching out to the most needy world with the best news that is on the planet. Jesus Christ came to save sinners. Hence the appeal that is coming from the elders that we do what we can in our home groups and some of the ministries that are able to have events over Easter, that we participate, we do what we can to make sure that we, as it were, set the sails to capture as much of the wind as possible. In fact, on Sunday, we have Pastor Ronald Kalifungwa coming to grace the pulpit here. He's a very busy man. He's just arrived from about 2 weeks in West Africa. But he's willing to come and bring the gospel here. What it means is that surely we should go out of our way to invite friends and neighbors. We can't just come as usual to hear the preaching of the gospel. So hopefully there will be a digital invitation card that will do its rounds. Let's make sure that we also send it out. Let's make appointments with friends and those of us with cars, pick them up, bring them here, so that even on Sunday, this place will be jam-packed, especially with friends and relatives who don't know Christ. Okay, so I thought I'd just add my voice. Elder Bota has already done so. Deacon Bidi Sakavuyi has also done so. So that we just use the next few days to make sure that we don't lose this God-given opportunity to reach the world while they are thinking about the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Very well then, Acts chapter 7. And the chapter consists 60 verses. I will be reading it, but not now. For now, I just want to read verse 51 to the end of this chapter as we consider the fourth sermon that shook the world, the fourth sermon. But let's just read those 10 verses, verse 51 to verse 60. It's a sermon, this time not preached by Peter, but by Stephen. And immediately after the sermon, he is killed. And he becomes the first Christian martyr in the whole of human history. Verse 51. You stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit, which is the title that I have given to the sermon. As your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who announced beforehand the coming of the righteous one, whom you have now betrayed and murdered. You who received the law as delivered by angels and did not keep it. Now, when they heard these things, they were enraged, and they ground their teeth at him. But he, full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And he said, "Behold, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." And they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and rushed together at him. Then they cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their garments at the feet of a young man named Saul. And as they were stoning Stephen, he called out, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." And falling to his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Oh, brethren, this is the fourth installment in the series of messages that I have entitled The Sermons That Shook the World. The first three of the sermons were preached by Peter. You remember the first one was on the day of Pentecost. The second one was when he and John healed the man who was a beggar and he was lame and used to spend all his time at the foot, rather the gate called Beautiful, the gate for the temple in Jerusalem. The third sermon was when they were summoned as apostles to give an account for what had just happened. And Peter again took occasion of what transpired at that point to preach the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. And what we have seen so far in all these messages is that the apostles were taking advantage of situations in order to preach the gospel. So it wasn't in a building like this where people have actually come for the purpose of worship to hear the message. It was taking advantage of providential happenings in order to preach. We've also noticed that they spent quite a bit of time showing from Scripture what it was that they were preaching, so that it was consistent with God's revelation. And then we've also noted that the messages were around the person and work of Jesus Christ. They deliberately made sure that they made a beeline to the cross so that people would realize that what transpired there is actually what the Bible has all along been teaching. It is the center of the universe. It's God's way of bringing sinners to himself. And then lastly, we have noticed that they preached for a verdict. They preached for a response. Somewhat towards the end of the sermon, they literally went after their hearers in such a way that these individuals had to respond. Well, that's exactly what we find in this final, rather fourth installment in this series. As I said, this time it's not so much a sermon by Peter, but by Stephen. And it is the longest recorded sermon in the whole of the book of Acts. And so as we take our time to go through it, we will make sure that we cover it in such a way that we can appreciate what is in it. It's a sermon that cost the preacher his life. He died because of the sermon that he preached. Ultimately, as I hope we will see, the sermon was about salvation by the grace of God alone. That's what it was about. Salvation by God's grace alone. It's a salvation that is not dependent on what you are doing or what you are meriting, especially meriting religiously. That this salvation does not involve any of that. It is completely independent of all that. It is by the grace of God through the finished work of our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, that's what the message is about, and I hope we shall learn something from it today. So there are three points that I want us to quickly go through. First of all, the context in which he speaks, which is largely in chapter 6, and then the content of it, which will be in the first part of chapter 7, the section we have not read, and then lastly, the conflict that arises out of this, which is the section that we have just read. And may God help us to learn salvation by grace alone. So let's begin with the context, and please go with me to chapter 6. Chapter 6. And basically, that section begins with a problem in the church. And it was a problem that had to do with the fact that there were great numbers now. You remember, by the time we came to chapter 4, the congregation had grown to 4,000 men. It's not even talking about the women and the children yet. 4,000. And inevitably, the poor among them began to be neglected. And especially the Greek-speaking widows, they were being neglected. And so the apostles got together and they got the congregation together and said, look, at the rate we're going to die in the process. This ain't going to work. So why don't you choose 7 men among you to whom we will give the responsibility to look after the widows so that we can continue concentrating on this work of prayer and the ministry of the word. Well, we read in verse 5 that one of the individuals that was chosen was Stephen. And he is described this way. Verse 5. And what they said pleased the whole gathering, and they chose Stephen. And then he is described this way, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. That's the way it's described. The others are just given names. These are their names. But this particular one seems to have stood out among the others. And in a sense, he would have been chosen so that he could also provide leadership within this first team of deacons that were ever appointed in the church of Jerusalem. Well, we are told that part of the fruit of that was that the gospel continued spreading. We see that in verse 7, and a great many of the priests became obedient to the faith. In other words, there was a major loss among the religious leaders. Those that were priests within Jerusalem, they began to come to faith in Christ. And as you know, when a religious establishment begins to lose its leadership, its key men, people don't just sit back and watch. They begin to say, guys, we need to do something about this bleeding. We need to stop what is taking place. Well, the one individual that then becomes a victim of this is Stephen. Because he stands out, first of all, by the miracles that he was doing, but also by his capacity to argue out the gospel from the scriptures. Verse 8, and Stephen, still in chapter 6, full of grace and power, was doing great wonders and signs among the people. Then some of those who belonged to the synagogue of the freemen, as it was called, and of the Cyrenians, and of the Alexandrians, and of those from Cilicia and Asia. Now, that's simply saying that when the Jews were scattered because of the Assyrian and Babylonian captivity, as they were scattered, and later on the Medes and the Greeks and the Romans, where they were scattered, they began to meet together in synagogues so that they could still maintain their religion there. And then they would be traveling long distances from wherever it was they were to the promised land, and especially to Jerusalem, and especially to the temple to worship God through the law of Moses, and especially through the ceremonial law. It was important to them. So here they are, they've come all the way to Jerusalem, and they are now listening to a preacher who seems to be suggesting that all that effort is useless. It does not bring them to a relationship with God. So inevitably, they are saying, let's take on this chap. Let's take him on. And so they are meeting with him in debate. So that's what this is all about. So they rose up and disputed with Stephen. They could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit with which he was speaking. So they failed to convince him. And because it was a public debate, everybody around was now looking at all that and saying they've been defeated. Yes, they've been defeated. And the result becomes underhanded ways now. Verse 11. Then they secretly instigated men who said, we have heard him speak. Notice now what they are bringing in. Blasphemous words. Now that's not fair. But you know, when people are defeated through logic, they start bringing in what you have not said or done. Blasphemous words against Moses and God. And they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes, and they came upon him and seized him and brought him before the council. And the council is basically the Supreme Court of Israel. It sits in Jerusalem for the entire nation of Israel. And they bring him there. And they set up false witnesses who said, this man never ceases to speak words against this holy place and the law. Now again, remember what I said earlier on. This holy place is the land, it is the city, and the temple that is there within the city. He's speaking against this holy place and the law. And the law is primarily talking about the things that people there needed to do in the context of this temple. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth would destroy this place, okay? So which he said it, but it not in blasphemy. He's saying it as a fact, which by the way happened about 60 years after this. and would change the customs that Moses delivered to us. Again, it's true, but it was in terms of the fact that Jesus was to fulfill all that, so that it was no longer necessary to be gallivanting all the way to Jerusalem once a year on the day of Pentecost and so forth. So, the customs that Moses delivered to us, and then gazing at him, all who sat in the council saw that his face was like the face of an angel. And then came this question that gave birth to the sermon. And the high priest realized this is the man who has lost quite a number of priests under him. The high priest said, "Are these things so?" In other words, he put him on his defense. Tell us. Now, that's the context in which Stephen opens his mouth and begins to speak. As I now proceed to deal with the content, the thing I want you to notice, as we shall be making our way through it, is this, that the Jewish religion was largely built around this. The land, the law, and the temple. Those three things. And we've already noticed it in chapter 6. These individuals were traveling all the way from the known world, coming into Jerusalem because of these three things. The land, the law, and the temple. The argument across chapter 7 is basically this from Stephen, that in fact, all these things are very recent. They're recent. God began having relationships with his people without these things. So what's your problem when I now come to tell you that a living relationship with God does not need these things? That's basically the point that he's going to make across chapter 7, and I hope to prove that to you in a moment. But let me try and put it this way so that you can understand. It's like the kind of Christianity that a lot of people have that is dependent on church, on the fact that I belong to such and such a church, therefore I must be a Christian. In that church, I've even been baptized, whether it's sprinkling or being immersed, whatever it is, I've even gone through that. And I go through regular rituals there. And then you have someone who comes and tells you that all that is useless when it comes to having a living relationship with God. It's useless. And then, of course, you, as we shall see in a moment, people often get upset about that. You can't say that my pastor or my priest or my bishop, whatever it is, that what he did to me is not necessary. You can't say that. Well, what Stephen is doing here is saying, well, look, let's go back to the time before your church came into existence. Let's go back. How was God saving sinners then? Okay, with that, I'll take about 5 to 10 minutes to go through this chapter, and I'll be emphasizing those points as Stephen deals with Abraham, and then deals with Joseph, and then deals with Moses, and so on. I want you to notice the emphasis. Let's go. Hang on to your hats, because we'll be galloping at breakneck speed. Brothers and fathers, hear me. The God of glory appeared to our father Abraham. And that's important because the entire structure hangs on the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But notice, when he was in Mesopotamia, before he lived in Haran. Now Haran is not even in the promised land. And said to him, go out from your land and from your kindred and go into the land that I will show you. Then he went out from the land of the Chaldeans. That's where he met God, in the land of the Chaldeans, and lived in Haran. And in Haran, he continued his relationship with the Lord. And after his father died, God removed him from there into this land in which you are now living. Yet, he goes on to say, he gave him no inheritance in it, not even a foot's length, but promised to give it to him as a possession and to his offspring after him, though he had no child. And God spoke to this effect, that his offspring would be sojourners in a land belonging again to others. We'll come back to it in a moment. But notice, it's not even in the promised land. To others who would enslave them and afflict them for 400 years. But I will judge the nation that they serve, said God. And after that, they shall come out and worship me in this place. And this place that is being talked about again is not the promised land. We shall come to it in a moment. And he gave him the covenant of circumcision. And so Abraham became the father of Isaac and circumcised him on the eighth day. And Isaac became the father of Jacob and Jacob of the 12 patriarchs. So, bang, we've looked at the patriarchs. And what we have seen is that the relationship that they had with God was not hanging upon the land, upon the law, and upon the temple. And yet, here they were, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, in a living relationship with God. Let's go on. Verse 9. And the patriarchs, jealous of Joseph, so he brings in Joseph now, sold him into Egypt. Listen to this. But God was with him. Where? Egypt. It was not in the promised land that he was with him. It was not in the temple, let alone putting on the ceremonial laws. God was with him and rescued him out of all his afflictions and gave him favor and wisdom before Pharaoh, king of Egypt, who made him ruler over Egypt and over all his household. Now there came a famine throughout all Egypt and Canaan and great affliction, and our fathers could find no food. But when Jacob heard that there was grain in Egypt, he sent out our fathers on their first visit. And on the second visit, Joseph made himself known to his brothers, and Joseph's family became known to Pharaoh. And Joseph sent and summoned Jacob, his father, and all his kindred, 75 persons in all. And listen to this. And Jacob went down into Egypt. And that's where he died. He and our fathers. And they were carried back to Shechem and laid in the tomb that Abraham had bought for a sum of silver from the sons of Hamor in Shechem. Again, the point he is making there is quite simple. Exactly the same point. Where was God having dealings with Joseph? In Egypt. He continues. Verse 17. Because now he's moving from Joseph, he's now moving to Moses. Where was God having dealings with Moses? Was it in the promised land where you've traveled major kilometers to come and meet with God here. Was it in Jerusalem? Was it in the temple? Well, listen, verse 17. But as the time of the promise drew near, which God had granted to Abraham, the people increased and multiplied in Egypt until there arose over Egypt another king who did not know Joseph. He dealt shrewdly with our race and forced our fathers to expose their infants so that they would not be kept alive. At this time, Moses was born. And he was beautiful in God's sight. And he was brought up for 3 months in his father's house. And when he was exposed, Pharaoh's daughter adopted him and brought him up as her own son. And Moses was instructed in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and he was mighty in his words and deeds. When he was 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brothers, the children of Israel. And seeing one of them being wronged, he defended the oppressed man and avenged him by striking down the Egyptian. He supposed that his brothers would understand that God was giving them salvation by his hand, but they did not understand. And on the following day, he appeared to them as they were quarreling and tried to reconcile them, saying, "Men, you are brothers. Why do you wrong each other?" But the man who was wronging his neighbor thrust him aside, saying, "Who made you a ruler and a judge over us? Do you want to kill me as you killed the Egyptian yesterday?" At this retort, Moses fled, and he became an exile. Where? In the land of Midian. Keep that in mind. In the land of Midian, where he became the father of 2 sons. Now, when 40 years had passed, an angel appeared to him. Where? In the wilderness of Mount Sinai. That's the land of the Midianites, by the way. That's where an angel appears to him. It's not in the promised land. It's not in Jerusalem. It's not in the temple. He goes on. In a flame of fire in the bush, when Moses saw it, he was amazed at the sight. And as he drew near to look, there came the voice of the Lord. "I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob." And Moses trembled and did not dare to look. Then the Lord said to him, "Take off the sandals from your feet, for the place where you are standing is holy ground." The land of the Midianites is holy ground. It's not in the promised land. It is not in Jerusalem. It is not in the temple. It is in the desert under a tree that God is meeting with the great Moses who led the people. "I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and I've heard their groaning, and I've come down to deliver them. And now come, I will send you to Egypt." The story continues. This Moses, whom they rejected, by the way, I'll come back to the rejection theme as we get to the end, whom they rejected, saying, "Who made you a ruler and a judge?" This man God sent as both ruler and redeemer by the hand of the angel who appeared to him in the bush, there in the land of the Midianites, there very close to Mount Sinai itself, where they will come back before long. This man led them out, performing wonders and signs in Egypt and at the Red Sea and in the wilderness for 40 years. Notice where all this is happening. It's in Egypt. It's in the wilderness. It's not even here that God is using his servant mightily. This is the Moses who said to the Israelites, and in comes Jesus, by the way, "God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers." This is the one who was where? Where? Listen. This is the one who was in the congregation in the wilderness with the angel who spoke to him out Mount Sinai and with our fathers. That's where he received the living oracles to give to us. Stephen is quite consistent in trying to break down this notion that there is a place that we must all go to if we are going to be in the right with God, to have a relationship with God. And he's making the point, sorry guys, that thesis does not stand the test of scripture. It does not stand the test of history. Our God has met our predecessors away from this place. Unfortunately, there is the rejection. Our fathers refused to obey him, but thrust him aside, and in their hearts they turned to Egypt, saying to Aaron, make for us gods who will go before us. As for this Moses who led us out from the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. This was the second rejection after the first one that took place in Egypt itself. And they made a calf in those days and offered a sacrifice to the idol and were rejoicing in the works of their hands. But God turned away and gave them over to worship the host of heaven, as it is written in the book of the prophets, that's in Amos. Did you bring to me slain beasts and sacrifices during the 40 years in the wilderness, O house of Israel? You took up the tent of Moloch and the star of your god Rephan, the images that you made to worship, and I will send you into exile beyond Babylon. So at this point, he's now ready to say that Joshua, after Moses, brought you now into this place. And even then, there was no temple in this place then. There was a moving tabernacle, a moving tabernacle. Number two, David, your greatest king, when he was ruling over you, he only thought about this. He never built it. It only came into existence when Solomon now came in. And even that is next to nothing. Let's read that. Verse 44. Because he's developing his argument. He's getting closer now. Our fathers had the tent of witness in the wilderness. Okay, that's the tabernacle. Just as he who spoke to Moses directed him to make it according to the pattern that he had seen. Okay, what we are learning in Exodus 35, 36, 37, and so on through our consecutive Bible reading. That's what he's referring to here now. Our fathers, in turn, brought it with Joshua when they dispossessed the nations that God drove out before our fathers. So it was a moving tabernacle which could go anywhere. So obviously, this place could not be what you guys are thinking it is. In fact, it was not. There it is. So it was until the days of David, who found favor in the sight of God and asked to find a dwelling place for the God of Jacob. And even him, notice, it was just the idea. Verse 47. But it was Solomon who built a house for him. So we finally arrived at where this place finally ended up being put up. And just as they are now salivating and licking their lips, he takes a spear, or maybe let's use another picture. He takes a grenade and throws it right there. Listen to this, verse 48. Yet the Most High does not dwell in houses
made by hands. As the prophet says, heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. What kind of house will you build for me, says the Lord? What is the place of my rest? Did not my hand make all this? Bottom line, he's saying, come on, guys. The prophets have made it clear that this thing that has been put up is just for significance purposes. You can't bottle God into a building because the whole earth is his. It's his footstool. The entire heaven is his throne room. In other words, you can have a living relationship with God anywhere on the planet. Even on the moon. Anywhere. You can have this living relationship with God. You don't need this temple. Now you can imagine by that time, the faces are like this. Our jobs are in jeopardy here. From what this guy is saying, we are losing our jobs. We better do something about this. So the anger on their faces is unmistakable. Imagine somebody who's for so many years dependent on, I was baptized by such and such a pastor, this holy person, or such and such a priest. And then you come and say, actually, water is nothing. That baptismal certificate is nothing. That priest or pastor is nothing. The implication, what's going on through that person's mind at that point, is not to sort of come and hit you a little bit on the shoulder and say, you know what, you're a very good speaker. I love what you're talking about. No! The person is thinking, you mean all these years? All this effort? No! And Stephen knew that this is not a ready congregation about to embrace his message. They've already dug in their heels. He could read it on their faces that they were angry. And so, he tells them exactly what they need to hear. And it is this. That just as Joseph was rejected by his brothers and in due season became the ruler, that they came to. Moses was rejected. Remember, we showed that. And in due season, he's the one who led the people across the wilderness. Jesus was also rejected. He will make the point shortly. But in actual fact, he is the savior of the world. The prophets have been rejected. In actual fact, they've been the ones that have been telling you the truth. In other words, rejection is part of the game. And you are guilty of doing exactly the same thing. Rejecting obvious truth. Verse 51. You stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit. As your fathers did, which we've already seen, so do you. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And there it is. And they killed those who announced beforehand the coming of the righteous one, the Son of God, the Savior of the world, whom you have now betrayed and murdered, you who received the law as delivered by angels, and yet you did not. Point is making is obvious. Let's face it. You are sinners. Doesn't matter how much religion you have gone through. You are still a sinner deserving the punishment of God. And that's something that we need to emphasize, especially to individuals who are religious, whether religious in a cult or religious in some kind of Christian environment, including religious as a Baptist, or religious in other religions. It is the bottom line that we still are sinners. We've all failed God. We need a substitute. And God has provided that substitute in the person of his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's able to save you wherever you are, even without the religious activities that make up so much of your life. Without that altogether, you can take it all and throw it into a rubbish pit, and does not affect your relationship with God. Your relationship with God hangs on repentance and faith in Christ. Full stop. Whether it's in your bedroom, that you fall on your knees as I did some 40 plus years ago, Jesus can save you there. It doesn't need to be in a church. And that's one reason why I'm a little uncomfortable with people who refer to a church building as a sanctuary. Because sanctuary means a holy place. Sanctity, holy. Friends, wherever you are with God is holy. It is. This is just a building. It's a convenience for us to meet in. In fact, towards the end of the day, it becomes an examination hall. Maybe that's why all the students pass, but let's move on. That's beside the point. The thing that I'm emphasizing is that salvation is independent of buildings. It's independent of water. It's independent of rituals. It's independent of Lord's Supper, Eucharist, Mass, whatever it is you might want to call it. It is wherever you are, in genuine repentance, trusting that when Jesus Christ died on that cross, it was the righteous one in the place of the unrighteous. And therefore to cry to the Lord Jesus, Jesus, save me or I perish. Well, let's hurry on to the conflict. I won't spend much time there. We already read it. The fruit of this sermon was that the hearers got angry. And sadly, brethren, that's what often happens with religious people. That's why very few religious people get saved. Because they want to still hang on to that which has been their assurance all along. Doesn't matter what the Bible is saying, I'm still going to hang on to this. And therefore they hate you and they want you out of their sight. Well, that was Stephen's experience as well. They refused to listen to him. They put their fingers into their ears. They made a loud noise so that they couldn't hear what he was saying. And then they rushed at him, dragged him out of town and just stoned him. It was instant justice. There was no going through any judicial process anymore. Just get rid of him. We don't want to hear this. Here's somebody who's taken them right across their Old Testament, right across. And he has argued in a way that you can't deny. It's there. But they must hold on to whatever this thing is rather than lose it. And therefore, Stephen died. Was it a loss? No. Because, as one of the early church fathers once said, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. When he was being killed, there was one young man who was there, one young man, who listened to this argument. And as stubborn as he may have wanted to be, it went right through his defense mechanisms. It was so. He heard it argued across the Old Testament. Later on, he became the foremost preacher of this same message that Stephen had preached here. He became the chief advocate of this message when finally God broke through. The other thing that no doubt hit Saul under the belt was the lack of bitterness in Stephen. Because for Saul, he had this anger that drove him like a bull in a china shop. And he was out there destroying believers, taking them to jail, seeking to crush the church. But he never forgot this man called Stephen, whose last words were, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And in your hands, I commit my spirit." In other words, you can argue against a philosophy, but you can't argue against a changed life. You can't. You can't. And as they always said in the first century, Christians died well. They died well. They were not cursing with bitterness against those that were slaughtering them. No, 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 no. They were praying for them while their heads were being chopped off. And the more they killed them, the more people became Christians. That's exactly what happened here. And often, that's what brings religious people to Christ. It's when they meet real Christians. That's what got me to seek the Lord and throw away everything, including my childhood baptism certificate. It was when my elder sister got converted. And we're in the same home. And the times we're going through were tough. In fact, terrible is the right word. And to hear her singing with joy, "Amazing Grace," in the midst of all that, I remember thinking to myself, if that's a Christian, I'm not. And I better seek the Lord. Seriously. Here's my question as I close. Have you heard the gospel of God's free grace? Have you? What's been your reaction? Has it been one of saying, "I give up everything else and I embrace Jesus Christ and Him alone as my Savior"? Not just giving up everything else in terms of giving up sin, but giving up everything else in terms of the things you've been depending on, my church membership, my baptism, my eating of the Lord's Supper, and whatever other religious activities you've been involved in. Just throw all that away and embrace Jesus Christ alone. If you have not, then you are resisting the Holy Spirit. You are. You are resisting the Holy Spirit. Because He's the one who has caused the Bible to be written. It's this history that He has caused to be known. The testimony of Scripture is clear. How were people being saved before churches and before baptism came into place? How? Because across history, individuals have come into a living relationship with the Lord. And instead of being angry and saying, I'll never come to this church again, I'll never listen to this preacher again, if I had a way, I would thrust a spear through his heart. Instead of doing that, just be honest. Do you have a living relationship in such a way that he enables you to live a holy and upright life? Has that happened? Because around you are those who can say, I came to Christ and he saved me and he changed me and I now have a living relationship. There's only one way of salvation. It's not through church. It's not through baptism. It's not through religious rituals. It is coming as an individual to this Jesus Christ. This is the same one that shook the world and cost the preacher his life. It's the same one that can turn into your salvation if you listen to it. Amen.
We thank the Lord for the preaching of his word. And let me ask that we take a moment to just meditate upon the word that has come to our hearing. And then after that, we'll sing in closing and we'll pray. Let me ask that we stand and we sing, Have Thy Own Way, Lord. Let me ask that we stand and we sing that the Lord might have his own way, as we have heard the word preached to us, that the Lord would, to each one of us, speak and that he would have his own way in our individual lives.
Have
And let's pray together, shall we? Our Father and our God in heaven, we are coming to you this afternoon asking that you might have your own way in our lives. Thank you for the word that has been preached to each one of us in our hearing who are here, reminding us of the things that sometimes religious people and everyone hangs on to, which have nothing to do with salvation of the soul of man. But we pray, God in heaven, that as your word has been opened to each one of us, and that Christ has been taught to us as the Savior of this world, we plead and ask that if there might be any amongst us who are still strangers to this Christ, who is the Savior of the world, that God in heaven, that you will not let them rest, but that they might come to that Christ for dear life's sake, that they might come to Christ for their salvation, that they might come, that they might have a relationship with you, our God. We plead, God, that you do these things for each one who is a stranger. But also pray for ourselves that know about the salvation that is in Christ, that such might be an encouragement, such might build our faith, that even when we face troubles, when we face difficulties in this life, that we might know that we are not the first ones, but also that you have never neglected your people and that you are always there for them. And so that we might be encouraged even to soldier on and to speak about Christ and to share the Christ that is the Savior of the world. We pray that you do these things for us. Thank you, O God, that we came and that we have been pleased to speak through your manservant, that even as he has spoken through your word to us, that even he, you might speak to him. We thank you, O God, and we pray that now you be pleased to dismiss us with your blessing and that your spirit will go before us. For we plead and ask for these things in the name of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray. Amen. We have come to the end of the morning service. We have another service at 16 hours. If you are able, we ask that you make yourself available, that you might come once again to worship our God and once again to listen to the preaching of God's word. The sermon that has been preached can be accessed on the various online platforms for the church of KBC. And that you might be able to download for yourself a copy and be able to once again listen to the preaching of the word. For those of you who are visiting us for the first time, as the rest of us will be going out through that door, we ask that you either use that door or use any other door, but please do make yourself available. There's a chalet this side that we might get to know you and that you get to know us better. Or if you have any questions, anyone who might have questions to ask, especially about the sermon that has been preached, we ask that you can see the pastor after the service in the pastor's office. Let me ask the ushers to lead us out as they will be singing softly and tenderly. Thank you very much for having come. See you once again in the afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you.